complain about the opposition to war that is so strong in most countries. And that's opposition to war even before people usually see the direct consequences of it. I mean, we're very fortunate in this country, being one of the richest countries in the world, one of the biggest imperialist countries in the world, historically, that in recent years, our wars have been conducted a long way away. Our wars mostly have not affected huge numbers of British civilians, and therefore people don't have the same view of war as you would have in Yemen or in Iraq, or indeed in Iran, where the war, the Iran-Iraq war in the 1980s was one of the most bloody wars of recent times. So I think it's fantastically important to understand that even when people don't have that direct experience, they don't like these wars. They don't like the fact that people are being killed, often by, practically by remote control. They don't like the fact that, for example, in Afghanistan, the bombing has continued and increased under Donald Trump, because they can't win a ground war against the Taliban, so they resort to the bombing of civilians. They don't like this, and the more that people see this, the less that they like it, and the more that they're informed about it, the less that they like it. One of the great things that we did over the Iraq war, but not just over the Iraq war, we did it over Lebanon in 2006, we've done it over Palestine, is to make it absolutely clear to people what these wars entail and whose interests they are being fought in. And I think this is something we have to talk about when we talk about Iran as well, because we're in a very frightening situation now in terms of the international situation and, to a certain extent, in terms of our own domestic situation. On Thursday, when Boris Johnson was believers in Downing, having lost every vote that he put to Parliament in the course of this week, and having been abandoned by his own brother as a minister and an MP. Who were the two visitors that he had in Downing this week? One was Benjamin Netanyahu, as he said, he's standing for election again in Israel, and he was the absolute hammer of the Palestinians in recent years. The other was Mike Pence, the American Deputy President, who is absolutely behind war on Iran. What did they come to talk to Boris Johnson about? They came to talk to him about increasing British support for the American policy as opposed to the EU policy, which I don't think is particularly great, but actually it was about saying, join with us, and already joined with the Americans in terms of patrols in the Strait of Hormuz, but it's also about saying, join with us with a much more aggressive policy towards Iran. And this is a week as well that Israel has already bombed and had strikes against Lebanon, and where it is repeatedly doing so, various targets in Iraq and Syria and elsewhere. So these are all very, very dangerous times for us. It's a situation where we now have John Bolton and Pence in particular, obviously with Trump as the president, who are more and more determined to get an outcome in the Middle East, which will see the overthrow of the Iranian regime. They're more and more determined on that path. Their two major allies in the Middle East, Saudi Arabia and Israel, are even more determined on this path. So this is what we're facing, and this is a serious situation that we're in. We can't separate it from the nearly two decades of war that we've now had as a result of the war on terror. The failure of the war in Afghanistan, the failure of the war in Iraq, the failure of the wars in Libya and Syria and Lebanon and everywhere else actually has resulted in them being more focused on wanting to challenge and overthrow what is going on in Iran. And that's the situation we're in. And I think for us, as anti-war activists in Britain, the truth is that the situation, as you see it in the news headlines, varies from week to week. You know, one week there's a big tank war going on and it seems to tango. The other week, it all seems to kind of calm down and goes off the front page and people think about things. So I think it's worth us bearing in mind when we look at this threat of war, because every time that there is an escalation of tension in the region, and there are going to be repeated escalations of tension in the region, if not least because of these patrols that are going on, because they will actually lead to increased tension, they will lead said to responses from Iran, which will then be portrayed as military and warlike responses. That's the point of doing it. It's worth us underlining what the threat of war is here and where it comes from. And I think we have to put the blame for all of this squarely at the door of Donald Trump and his administration. Firstly, in terms of the abandonment of the nuclear deal, the JCPOA, which has been referred to, this is something that the United States did more than a year ago, opposed by everybody else in various other governments who had signed up to it, including the British government, because, again, as has been said, nobody could kind of see a particular problem with what was happening in Iran, but Trump was determined to blow that up. And then he increased imposition of sanctions. Now, when you look at the sanctions on Iran, to me, you know, we talk about military intervention. To me, sanctions are economic warfare. Now, I remember in 1991, when the first Gulf War ended, lots of people on the left thought sanctions were a good alternative to war. But, you know, we don't want war, we want the Americans to withdraw, we want all these things. Okay, we'll agree to sanctions because that just seems like a non-military intervention. Of course, it's nothing of the sort, because over the years, many people died, as Madeleine Albright said, that was the price worth paying in terms of the Iraqi children. Many people died. It destabilised the societies, it caused real hardship for people, and then we shouldn't see it as something which is just a kind of a neutral effect, or just affects a few people's bank accounts. It doesn't. It's an economic warfare, and we have to be opposed to it. The same is true when you look at the sieges of the tankers. I mean, I was absolutely astonished at the behaviour the British Royal Marines, I don't know why I suppose I should be so astonished by the United States and by the Royal Marines, in terms of seizing the Iranian tanker off the coast of Gibraltar. What on earth is that about? What it's about is actually a form of piracy on the high seas. That's the only word you can really use to describe it, where they just seized it, they held the crew at gunpoint, they kept the tanker for what, nearly 2 months, and now it's been released. When it was released, the Americans wrote to the captain of the tanker saying, well, we can give you millions of dollars if you'll take it to a harbour where we can be given it and you don't give it to anyone that Iran wants you to give it to Syria or anybody else. I mean, this is the kind of gangster behaviour which is something that will lead to more conflict, not less. So I think in all of those cases, let's look at where the conflict originates, not how people respond. People will respond in all sorts of ways, and there may be ways that we don't think are particularly good ways. Let's look at where the root of this problem is, and the root of this problem, again and again, you have to come back to the whole role of British imperialism, of American imperialism, and what they've been doing in the region for decades and decades now.